students. So today we are going to discuss the success of our nuclear shell model. As in the previous module, we had already learned the nuclear shell model filling of the various nucleons, that how the nucleons are filled in the respective levels. As you can see here, this was the energy level diagram of the various nucleon filling. And this has been discussed that this was the arrangement of the filling of the shells when we did not consider the spin orbit coupling. When we considered the spin orbit coupling, that is the orbital and the spin momentum were taken into consideration. So the energy level 1s, 2p, 3d, 2s, they are split, where the s level does not encounter any splitting. They are left out with only one energy level, that is 1s 1 by 2, 2s 1 by 2, 3s 1 by 2 and so on. Whereas all the rest of all the levels are split into two levels depending upon the value of J, which is equal to L plus S and L minus S, where we had seen that L plus S will be placed at a lower energy level and L minus S will be placed at a higher energy level. So these were the energy levels of the case when we had considered this spin orbit coupling. So the representation was NL, J, L minus S, L plus S, where L minus S is placed at a higher energy, L plus S is placed at a lower energy. And since the states are occupied by two nucleons which will have opposite spins, so the number of nucleons per level, that is 2J plus 1, will be equal to, for S it is 2, for P there will be 4, for 2P half there will be 2, so that the P level will have a total of 6 nucleons in its level. The D will have 3D 5 by 2 will have 6, and 1 by 2 S will have 2, 3D 3 by 2 will have 4, so that this level will have a total number of nucleons equal to 12. And if we see the total nucleons that are being added in the successive levels, so they come out to be 2, 8, 20, 28, 50, 82 and 126. And what we saw, that these numbers were nothing but the magic numbers. So these magic numbers were explained very successfully using the nuclear shell model. So in this module, we shall be explaining what were the successes that were explained, very well explained by the nuclear shell model. So the first success that came for the nuclear shell model was the magic number, that the magic numbers that we saw here, that these magic numbers were very well explained by the nuclear shell model. So the magic numbers are explained by the nuclear shell model. Second, since we had seen that the splitting of the energy levels with respect to the spin orbit coupling, and the nucleons when we fill in that particular subshells are double, that is 2J plus 1, so it is 2, 4, 2. Why this? Because in one shell there we can accommodate two nucleons which is of opposite spins. So we saw that the energy sublevels occupied by the two particles of opposite spins accounts for the tendency of the nuclear abundance of even number of proton and even number of neutron. That is, the stability that has been found in nature for the stable nucleides was for the combination of the even proton and even neutron. That was 126, as we had already studied that there were 126 stable nucleides for the combination of even proton and even neutron. So this justification was also given by the nuclear shell model. Third success came for the magnetic moment, that the magnetic moment calculated by the theoretical values and the practical values were in accordance with each other. So we say that the magnetic moment is proportional to the total angular momentum. So the total angular momentum will be given by the angular momentum of the last unpaired nucleon present in the configuration of any element. So if there is any last unpaired nucleon, so the J of that last unpaired nucleon will contribute to the total angular momentum J. And we had already calculated that the magnetic moment is proportional to the angular momentum value. So we can say that the magnetic moment is also dependent upon the last unpaired odd nucleon. So if we see that we know that the magnetic moment of the proton is given by 2.79 nuclear magneton, and we know that the magnetic moment of a neutron is given by -1.91 nuclear magneton. So if we supposedly we consider a case of deuteron, that is 1H2. So since 1H2 has two nucleons, that is one proton and one neutron, so they would be paired in one level with upspin and downspin, such that the total angular momentum of the deuteron will be equal to zero, which is calculated, as well as which is theoretically proved that it is having a J equal to zero. So it has a configuration of 1H2. So we can see here that 1s, 1 by 2 is the lowest energy level, and it will contain two nucleons. So both the nucleons, one proton and one neutron, will have a configuration for the deuteron as 1s, 1 by 2 raised to power 2, that is to 2j plus 1. So it will have a configuration of 1s, 1 by 2. So it contains one proton and one neutron. So the magnetic moment of the theoretical calculation of the deuteron has been found out to be 0.86. So does this theoretical value of the magnetic moment is in accordance with the practical value or with the calculated value or the experimental value? So if we see with the calculation that if it is having one proton and one neutron in the nucleus, so the total magnetic moment of the nucleus should be equal to 2.79 magnetic moment of the proton minus the magnetic moment of the neutron, because neutron is having a negative value. So 2.79 minus 1.91 nuclear magneton value gives out to the value of 0.88 nanometer. So it has been found that the theoretical value which was proposed by various models, that the magnetic moment of the deuteron should be 0.86 nuclear magneton, and the calculative value, that is the measured value, came out to be 0.88 nuclear magneton, are in accordance with each other. So nuclear shell model was very well in explaining the nuclear magnetic moments of the nucleus. So this was the serious success of the nuclear shell model, that it could account for the magnetic moments of the various nucleus, and it could also give the angular momentum. So next we can say the success came for the quadrupole moment. As we all know that what do you mean by quadrupole moment? Quadrupole moment tells the departure of the sphericity of the nucleus, ki how much it is departing from its spherical structure. So if it is having a value q equal to 0, so the nucleus is considered to be perfectly sphere. But if it is having a positive value or it is having a negative value, so it will have some quadrupole movement, and it will be not a perfect sphere. It will be either a prolate sphere or a oblate sphere. So we had found that when we start with the configuration, when the shells begin to fill up with the neutrons and protons, so it takes that when the new shell begins to form, when we start filling the nucleons in the nucleus, so we have q take to value of negative. So when the nuclear number goes on increasing for the different elements or different nucleons, when the number of protons or neutrons are increasing, so what we see that as the number of nucleon increases, the q becomes less negative, or it starts becoming positive, or its value starts increasing. It becomes less negative, its value is increasing. So when the shell is 2/3 filled, when the shell of the particular nucleon, when the shell is filled with 2/3 of the nucleons, then what happens that the q takes a maximum positive value. So q takes a positive value, its shape changes. So and thereafter, when it is 2/3 filled, and if the filling further continues, then the positive value starts decreasing. So the positive value decreases to q equal to 0. So q equal to 0 means that the nucleus will take a shape of perfect sphere. So at that time it is found, when the q value equal to 0, then the shells are filled with the nucleon equal to the magic numbers. So it is found that at magic numbers, when the nucleus of the when the nucleons of the nucleus are having a total of nucleons equal to the magic numbers, then the electric quadrupole movement of the nucleus was considered to be 0, is equal to 0, and it is having a perfectly spherical shape. So this accounted for the quadrupole moment, the change in shape of the nucleus, that the nuclear shell model was very successful in explaining the quadrupole moment, where the shape of the nucleus could change from oblate to prolate to spherical symmetricity. So it was found that the nucleus took the shape of spherical symmetricity at the number of nucleons matching to the magic numbers. So the shell model was very well in explaining the quadrupole movement also. So next property that it could explain was the nuclear isomerism. What do you mean by nuclear isomerism? Nuclear isomerism means that certain nuclei stays in a excited state. Means there are ground state, there are excited state. So during some transitions, the nuclei are excited to higher excited states. So they live in their excited states for quite a long time. They could range their lifetime, half-life from a microsecond to a very long years also. So it was taken that the nuclear time scale is measured for the half-life as 10 raised to power minus 22 seconds. So this is the half time, 10 raised to minus 22. So when we go on adding up the successive half-life time, so it accounts to quite large number of years. So the nucleus could stay in the excited state, depending upon the element, it could stay in the excited state from microsecond to many years. So the states of the nuclei which have long life are found for nuclei which are having the neutron or proton number near the end of the shell. Near the end of the shell means when the neutron or proton numbers are configuring to the magic numbers. So such nucleus are called as the nuclear isomers or the isomeric states. So it has been found, it has been calculated that we have four types of isomeric states or four types of groups, and these four distinct groups are called as the island of isomerisms. Okay, beta. So these are called the island of isomerism, means there the nucleus are divided into four distinct groups for the number of neutron and the number of proton lying between certain values. So the first group, which is under the island of isomerism, are when the N or Z is lying between 19 and 27. So here you can see that this is 28 is the magic number. So the shell is being filled at 28. So the first island is lying between, when it is nearing the end of the shell, so it is from 19 to 27. Similarly, when it is filling up to 50, the magic number is at 50. So the second island is at the 39 and 49. So it is again at the end of the filling of the shell, that is 39 to 49. Third is coming at 69 to 81. Since the next magic number is at 82, so the end of the shell is filling at the number of 69 and 81. Okay? And the fourth group of the island of isomerism is close to the figure 126. So the neutron number or the proton numbers are lying between 111 and 125. Comprises of the fourth distinct group of the island of isomerism, where the neutron or proton are lying between 111 to 125. So we say, what do you mean by island of isomerism, or what do you mean by isomeric state? That those nuclei which are in the excited state, and they could live in their excited state from a time lying between microsecond to very long lifetime. So such nuclei which have a long duration of their lifetime are called as the isomeric states. And these isomers which have long life, they are found for the neutron or proton number that is close to the end of the shell, or that they are close to the magic numbers. So there were four groups of isomers, isomeric. So first group belonged to the neutron and proton number lying between 19 to 27. Second group from 39 to 49. Third group was lying from 69 to 81. And fourth group was lying from 111 to 125. You can see that the magic number close here is 28. Here the magic number close is 50. Here the magic number close is 82. Here the magic number closes 126. So that is why it is written that the isomeric states with long life are found for the nuclei which have neutron or proton number near the end of the shell. That is having the nucleon or proton number equal to the magic numbers. So these four distinct groups were called as the island of isomerisms. So some other successes are also there. So next we see that what are these successes. So the next success that we shall be discussing was that the nuclear shell model was able to tell about the angular momentum of the nucleus. So angular momentum of the nucleus was also given by the last unpaired nucleon present in the nucleus. So in the nucleus we can have three type of combinations. One is that we could have even number of neutron and even number of proton, or we can have one even and one odd combination. That means we can have even number of neutron or odd number of proton, or odd number of neutron and even number of proton, or we could have both neutron and proton to be odd combination. So how do we calculate the angular momentum for the even combination? Since in the even combination all the nucleons, both the protons and neutrons, would pair off. So if they are pairing, they would cancel each other's effect. So if they cancel each other effect, so the resultant angular momentum of the nucleus would be equal to zero. So all the NZ pairs cancel out each other's spin, and the orbital angular momenta or the angular momentum of the nucleus will be equal to zero. So that is in the case, supposingly, for example, we have the oxygen 16. So in oxygen 16, we have 8 protons and 8 neutrons. We had already discussed the energy level filling of the nucleons. So from this, we can say that the lowest energy is 1s 1 by 2, then it is 2p 3 by 2, then it is 2p 1 by 2. And the subscript is the J value, and the superscript is the number of nucleons per shell, that is the 2j plus 1. So we have filled the energy level for 8 protons and 8 neutrons. Both will have the same configuration. So it is 1s 1 by 2 subscript 2, 2p 3 by 2 subscript 4, 2p half subscript 2. So all the protons and neutrons are pairing up and is having opposite spins. So the j that is coming out to be 0 for even number of neutron and even number of proton. So for even odd combination, the angular momentum contribution will be due to the extra nucleon that is present in the nucleus. So the half integral spin of the single extra nucleon will combine with the rest of the integral spin of the nucleus. So the momentum, J, angular momentum J, will be what? It would be half integral plus integral, which will be again half integral value. So that is why the angular momentum will take the value of half integral. As in the case we discussed for the fluorine 17, we have 9F17, where we have 9 protons and 8 neutrons. So 8 neutrons, we have the same configuration again. It is 1s 1 by 2 raised to power 2, 2p 3 by 2 raised to power 4, 2p half raised to power 2. So for neutrons, all neutrons pair off, so there is no contribution from the neutron factor. So for the 9 protons, we have the configuration 1s 1 by 2 raised to power 2, 2p 3 by 2 raised to power 4, 2p 1 by 2 raised to power 2, 3d 5 by 2 raised to power 1. So here the last unpaired proton is residing in the d subshell. So it is from this value, the subscript j is 5 by 2. So that is why the angular momentum will be 5 by 2, because if we want to calculate the J value, so J vector momentum ki magnitude value is given by small j into j plus 1 h cross. So we know the J value is here 5 by 2. So if we substitute the value of 5 by 2 into 5 by 2 plus 1 and take its square root, multiply it by h cross, so we can calculate the magnitude value of J in terms of h cross. So that is why we are saying here the angular momentum is equal to 5 by 2, or the angular momenta is 5 by 2, and for D here the L is corresponding to 2. So when we take the odd contribution, we have odd proton and odd neutron. So here in the neutron and proton, there will be both an extra proton and extra neutron. So if there is an extra proton and extra neutron, so neutron will have half spin and a proton will have a half spin. So these half spin can combine in either way. These can combine either in opposite directions so that the resultant is zero. If they combine in the same direction, either up spin or in the down spin. Sorry, here both are down spins or here both are up spins. So here it will be plus one and here it will be minus one. So what we see that the J value is taking an integral value. So that is why extra neutron and extra proton whose half integral spins contribute towards the J, which would be integral. So they would combine in such a way that either they combine in up spin down spin to give a zero value, which is integral value, or they combine both in up spins or both in down spin, again it will yield an integral value. So for ordered nucleon combination, the angular momentum will have a integral value, but for even odd combination, angular momentum will have a half integral contribution, and for even it will have zero value. So in this way, the nuclear shell model was successful in telling us the angular quantas or angular momentum values. So what we saw there, we saw that there was some exception also. So we consider one exception of the filling of the 33 arsenic 75. In 33 arsenic 75, we have 33 protons and 42 neutrons. So when we consider the filling of 33 protons, what we get? We get the configuration 1s 1 by 2 raised to power 2, 2p 3 by 2 raised to power 4, 2p 1 by 2 raised to power 2, 3d 5 by 2 raised to power 6, 2s 1 by 2 raised to power 2, 3d 3 by 2 raised to power 4. As you can see here, we have 3d 3 by 2 raised to power 4, then is 4f 7 by 2 raised to power 8, then is 3p 3 by 2 raised to power 4, and then we have 4f 5 by 2 raised to power 6. So in this, since there is only one 33rd proton, is only the first nucleon here, so here it comes in number 1. So here 33 is filled, 32 protons are filled up to this shell. And when we fill the 42 with neutrons, so what we get? We get the same values, 4f 5 by 2 raised to power 6, 3p 1 by 2 raised to power 2, and 5g 9 by 2. And here there are 2 neutrons instead of 10 neutrons. So we are having 2. So 42 completes here at 5g 9 by 2, 2. So here the 2 neutrons would be pair of to give no contribution. So the contribution is coming from this term. But what is here that? That instead of here changing, that we said that when we go to the higher orders, here P 3 by 2 is coming at a lower energy than at the P 5 by 2. But in the case of arsenic, that 4F 5 by 2 is at lower energy and 3P 3 by 2 is at the higher energy. So the filling of the F level takes place rather than the filling of P level. So the value of J is not, in case of arsenic, is 5 by 2. Here the J value takes 3 by 2 value. Here all the F levels are filled first and then the unpaired neutron is present in the J 3 by 2 level. Means that there are 5. So here all the 5 levels of F are filled, but 3 by 2 is also, there is a nucleon left in the P 3 by 2 level. So the J value takes the value of 3 by 2. So in this case, we can calculate the other factors also, the parities and the spins. So some exceptions has to be remembered, just as in the case of arsenic, where the P level was not filled first, F level was at the lower energy value which filled, and the extra nucleon was in the P level. So the other point which could be explained by the nuclear shell model was the spin and parities. The spin and parities was also said or also proposed by the extra nucleon that was present in the nucleus. So from the extra nucleon we could tell that in which level it is lying. From there we can tell the parity also. So the parity has been, what do you mean by parity? So parity means that if we define a wave function by psi x, y and z, and if we reverse the coordinate, change the coordinates from positive to negative coordinates, from minus x, minus y, minus z. If both the wave function have the same value, both are not differing with any sign, both are having the same value, that it is taken to be positive. So we say that the parity of the function of the state is even. But if it is differing by a negative sign, when we interchange the coordinates by minus sign and the wave function of psi x, y, z is differing from psi of minus x, minus y, minus z with a negative sign, then in that case we say that the state is having an odd parity. So in such a case, the parity is given by p is equal to minus 1 raised to power l. So just as in the case of fluorine, we have seen that the last unpaired nucleon is residing in the d level and d is equal to l by 2. So here if we calculate the parity of the fluorine, so here it will be minus 1 raised to power 2, which will be a positive value. So we say that the parity of fluorine will be positive, or it could be said as it could take the value of even. So it will be even parity. So I hope that you must have all understood about the nuclear shell model and what were the successes, what points that the shell model was able to explain. It could explain the magic numbers, it could explain the abundance of the stable nucleus, which are in the combination of even proton and even neutrons, where 126 stable nucleides are possible for even combination. We could justify the value of the nuclear magnetic moment. We could calculate the values of angular momentum. We can calculate spin. We can calculate parity. We can calculate electric quadrupole moment. We can also tell about the isomeric states, where the isomers have large, long half-life time, where the nuclei are close to the end of the shell, that is the close to the magic numbers, where they had island of isomerism having four groups. So all these factors, all these properties were very well explained using the nuclear shell model, where we had this filling of the nuclear shell model, and from these filling of the nucleons we can easily propose the values of the parity, spins, angular momentum, nuclear magnetic moments and so on. So I hope that I have justified in explaining you the shell models and the nuclear models. Thank you.